So in this session, we shall consider the SQL data manipulation language. We have already seen the data query language as a SQL, what it stands for. But data manipulation language means actually changing data. And this involves what operations? We've been saying that again, inserting rows, deleting rows, and changing values in some row, updating some values. There are three simple operations. So as you would have guessed, there are exactly three simple statements in SQL. All other querying is done using select, and these three statements constitute the bulk of DM or data manipulation. We shall initiate some discussion on the transactions. I don't think we'll be able to complete it, but we'll introduce that topic and continue the discussion later. First of all, we note the notion of views, and then we'll look at the data manipulation. Or the course project again keeps appearing here. Remember, I told you that while the database schema presents a logical view to the programmers, end users might have to be exposed only to part of this schema. I don't want to give them full access to everything. So consequently, the notion of a view exists. We shall see what views are and what they mean in terms of our capability of restricting access and so on. First of all, the definition of a view. To create a view, we use create view V or as V. V is the name of that view, as query expression. Query expression is any legal expression, and the name of the view is V. So view is the keyword. Create view V means create a view which is different from the logical schema of one or more tables. That view is to be created as a query expression, and that becomes the view. We shall see what exactly it means. Create view HH students as select sroll, sname, sroom, scpi from student where shostel equal to 8. What will this do? Ordinarily, if I had done select sroll, sname, etc., what would I have got? From the table, I would have got all rows where hostel number is 8. But I am not finding, I am not asking this query. I want to present only these rows as a logical view to someone whose business is to know about hostel 8 students. I mean, why should hostel 9 students know about CPI of hostel 8? That way, why should hostel 8 students know about each other's CPI is a different question, but hypothetically. So let's say I want to restrict it like that. Here what it means is, this HH students is the name of the view. Effectively what it is doing is, it is creating a dummy table structure. That dummy table structure is a view called HH hostel. You will anticipate that this dummy table structure can be given as a permission to some people to run queries on. Consequently, this view is treated subsequently as a table, and I can run any SQL query on this view. Whenever I run an SQL query on this view, I know that only entries in this view will be students who have hostel number 8. I can restrict the schema also to a subset. For example, if I say select sroll, sname, sroom and nothing else, then the view will have only HH students. Not only that, its schema of this HH student, there is a schema to the view, will be only roll number, name and room. Now this view, what do we use it for? I can run a query on a view. Select sname from HH students where sroom is greater than 300 and SCPI is greater than 9. So I want to get all the top performing students on the third floor of my hostel. Now when I run this query, I will get only the names of people staying in my hostel. I will not get all students from all IIT. Meaningful for some secretary who is handling accommodation or whatever what. Okay. You see the value now? I have defined the base tables. I can define a view. Notice that, let's go back to the previous slide. Notice that the view is defined by a select query. It therefore implies that the select query can be as complex as you want, involving multiple tables. Whatever gets selected as a result is the view. So I can have very complex views which are created as entities, as single table. Because you will get a single table at the end with its appropriate schema, which will now be available for being treated as a table, additional table. It's a dummy table, however. Okay? Is this clear? This is the notion of the thing.
Here is a problem.
When I say select S name from HH students, where S name, S room is greater than 300 and SCPI is greater than 9. Suppose I created that view, let's go back to the previous slide. I created that view yesterday. Okay. Then 1 month later, I run this query. Within that 1 month, some students have gone from second floor to third floor. Some students would have got 9.3 CPI instead of 8.9 earlier. Some students have got 6.4 instead of 9.1. Anyway, it's possible. What will happen then to this query? After all, you want this query to return results which are true at the time of running this query, not true at the time of when you form the view, right? That is the expectation. So SQL guarantees that by saying that when I create view, it only creates the schema of the view. It's an empty table. It's an empty table. What it means is, every time I run a query, this or any other query on that view, at that point in time, the actual data in that view is created by running that view definition query. Which means SQL guarantees that any time you run a query on a view, the information that you will get will be absolutely current, contemporary information, because the actual query in the view, let's go back to this thing, this is the query. By this query, only a coca of a table will be created with its schema. No data will be inserted. When I run a query on the view like this, first it will run the original query which created the view. That is called materializing the table. Effectively, you have an empty table and you are filling it up with appropriate values. That filling up is called materialization. Materialized view is a very strong research topic. Because when do you materialize? If every time you have to materialize, then how much work that fellow has to do? Suppose you have data which does not change normally. Is it worthwhile to keep materializing? So there are cases where you want to maintain a materialized view. Particularly when you look at statistics, calculation, etc., where you know that a few changes here and there will not change the overall statistics. You might want to keep a view materialized and update that view only once in a month, once in a 15 days, etc. That's an important consideration in constructing information system. What we are discussing here is the implication of a view. So create view creates a schema with a table. It's an empty table. It's an empty logical table, no permanent table. Anytime I run a query on that table, first the view is materialized and then the query is run. Is that okay? Is that clear? Fine. So this is a sample query on a view. And the create view statement only creates the schema of the view. It is materialized only when a query is executed. Temporary views are created as a result of a query. What is the purpose of this? Look at this. Select SH, CPI average from select S hostel, AVG SCPI from student group by S hostel as result SH, CPI AVG. This query is actually creating a view with schema SH, CPI AVG. That means it has one hostel number, average CPI, one hostel number, average CPI. If I want to treat this result as a table in an immediate query which follows, then this would be a temporary view. We'll not go into details of this. There are so many details. Again, you can read more about views and find out things there. We'll now come back to the actual data manipulation. You know, we said DDL, data definition language, DML, data manipulation language, and DCL, data control language. In DML, we have studied select statement, which is actually not a manipulative thing. It's only query. It does not change value. There are three statements which change values: insert, update, and delete. We'll look at each statement one by one. They are very simple statements. If you want to insert record of a new student joining the institute, insert into student values this, comma, this, comma, this, comma, this, comma, comma. Can you figure out what this would mean? This is roll number. This is name. This is hostel. This is room number. And what is this? CPR, but no value is given. This means null is inserted. Very good. Provided that column is nullable. If that is not nullable, this insert statement will result in an error. If that is nullable, this will insert this row. If I want to insert all new students who come into IIT, then actually I will have to execute one insert statement like this for every student. It's a painful thing. It's a painful thing, right? For every student, I have to type insert into student values, this. What would you prefer as information system people, but those who know some programming and those who know how data is organized? For example, if 600 students join the institute, it is quite likely that you will have this data in some text form in a file. You can always create that, you know, roll number, name, hostel number, room number. This data you can create. Now you got a file. Now if you really want SQL statements to be typed for each student, that's a painful task. In short, in such situations, what you are looking for is the facility to bulk update. That means you want to tell SQL engine that I want to insert in student, but read from this file, take each row as an equivalent of insert statement, create your own internal insert statement that you want, but insert all of these. That would make sense, right? Such a facility exists in most of the database products, not in most, all database products. Unfortunately, that syntax is not a standard syntax in SQL. It actually came in SQL 99, but that is not often followed. But those utilities exist. Here is another example of insert. Insert into student, S role, comma, S hostel. Assume that I have only roll number and hostel number available. I have nothing else available. Assume, of course, that all other fields are nullable. Then, if I prescribe a subset of a schema in the insert statement, I am required to give values, only two values, or only as many values as there are attributes maintained here. Ordinarily, this will not be done. Again, ordinarily, as I said, for bulk inserts, you will have some utility or some format of SQL. But if, let's say, one odd student joins late after 5 days, then you don't want to insert his data into a file and then run the bulk utility. You want directly things to be inserted, and the insert statement can be written. Here is another insertion example. Insertion, insert into reg, select S role, comma, CS771 from reg, where C code equal to CS634 and S role in, select S role from student where SCPI is greater than 9.5. Without explaining anything, can you figure out what this thing is doing? It is inserting into reg. So that means it is creating new registration records, but without any data values being given. So can you figure out the meaning of what this is trying to do? Okay, to understand this, let us go backward. It is obvious that an inner query will be executed sometime or the other. What will this inner query do? Select S role from student where SCPI is greater than 9.5. That means I am getting all roll numbers, okay, who have got CPI greater than 9.5, and all of those who are registered for CS634. Let us say head of the CS department decides that people who are very great performers in academics and have registered for CS634 will automatically get registration for a PhD level 7 level course. Now instead of telling all of you, saying those who have 9.5, please enroll, I can run an SQL query saying anybody who got a CPI greater than 9, anybody who has registered for CS634, take that fellow's roll number and insert that roll number and this specific code as a duet, because in reg, I need to insert minimally these two as the primary key. So you can see automatic registration. So insertion is not necessarily by giving explicit values, as we saw in this last slide, where you give explicit value. Insertion could also be based on some business logic which has been defined. Okay. Clearly, such decisions will be taken by the SIRET at an appropriate point in time. These decisions will be only valid for that semester. Next semester, some other decision may come. Consequently, an information system for which you have defined schema, written all SQL queries, defined screens, etc., you may still have to write some small code to reflect that business decision. That is where SQL comes in handy as opposed to conventional programming language. No wonder these queries cannot be written by end user or operator, but programmers can do that very quickly without having to spend time. This one you will like. You want to modify values. So how do you modify values? Modification is done by update statement. So you are asking how will I change? You will say update reg. So you are defining the table that is to be updated. Table updated means some rows have to be updated, some or all rows. The statement here says set grade equal to AA, where C code equal to CS634. What it means? Change the grades of all CS634 students to A. This will do it automatically. Now you will know why such update powers cannot be given to all students. Okay, won't make sense. So this will also tell you about the need for security, very tight security. But this here demonstrates the power of SQL. You can update a large number of rows by automatically based on some business criteria which you have taken a decision. This I like. Increase faculty salaries by 50%. Update faculty, set salary equal to salary star 1.5. Please note that this statement is almost like an assignment statement in a programming language. It's not an equation or a condition. So it will first take the current value of salary multiplied by 1.5 and replace the old value by the new value. Set statement does that. Easy, you can understand? Okay. I can of course say set salary equal to 14,500 if there is an explicit salary which is at the time of appointment being given. That is possible, of course. Delete. Delete registration records of CS634 for students with CPI less than 6.5. This is not actually a hypothetical case. This is a postgraduate elective. And as you know, in IIT, postgraduate electives can be taken by undergraduate students whose CPI is 6.5 or more. That's the rule. Now suppose some student registers for it because he has talked to me and he has asked me, is that CPI required? I said, no, this is a fundamental course in information systems. You can always take it. So he wants to register for it. But the system must not permit because there is a Senate rule. So if some registration has gone like that, this delete statement, which says delete from reg where SROL in, select SROL from student natural join reg where CPI is less than 6.5 and C code is equal to CS634. Remember, we are not deleting the student, we are deleting that row of the registration record which matches this. Of course, this does not distinguish between undergraduate and postgraduate students. So our meaningful interpretation of this query will be that for some reason FATAC wants only 6.5 or more CPI fellows to be in the class. That is the interpretation. If you want that undergraduate student condition, then you must either have another flag and attribute in the student table which will identify that student table as UG, PG, whatever, and then you'll have to say select this where CPI is less than 6.5 and C code is this and the flag is equal to UG or whatever, right? Is this clear? So delete is a very powerful statement. Again, you can delete not just one row but multiple rows. If you say delete from reg where SROL equal to some roll number, then all registration records of that student will be deleted. What will happen if you say delete from reg without any where condition? Yes. So here is an example. Remove all students of hostel 8. Delete from student where S hostel equal to 8. Fire all faculty. Delete from faculty. It's a very powerful statement. You will agree that therefore, whatever access rights may be given to general users, delete access rights must never be given because you could cause a chaos. Okay, so that also stresses both the power of SQL for data manipulation and the need for the highest selective security. Okay, and we'll see how that highest selective security is provided. But are you clear on this? Basically, insert, update and delete are the three statements which can cause change in the data in the database. And no other statement exists. So in fact, I remember Divakar Nigam, who ran a company called Softec and wrote some of the finest compilers in COBOL and Fortran and so on. when he was trying to construct a database, he was trying to tell me that, look, I have written compilers for languages which have so many commands. SQL statement has what? Select, insert, delete, update. Then I told him that, no, Baba, there is query optimization, there is integration. He figured out. When he tried to construct that, he said, okay, let Oracle and others write databases. Now he develops document management system. But please understand, the power of the language is not defined by the number of different commands that you have, but how expressive those commands are, what action those can cause. In terms of information system, you want to change the data, insert, delete, update, or you want to extract the data, select. Nothing else is required. Enough complexity can be built by using the inner queries and nested queries and so on. And now we turn our attention to rights, security, authorization. You must not be able to trample with the security of the system in terms of data. So the powerful SQL features can be misused to corrupt the contents of our database. That is why there is one Brahmarshi defined for database. He is called database administrator. He is the king emperor of database. Nothing happens inside that without the permission of the individual called database administrator. Okay. He might be an experienced programmer, but even the director of the institute will have to get authorization from that DBA to do anything with the database. You will agree that such a centralized security for the major things have to be created, and database permits you to do that. The other users, other than database administrator, the database administrator has full rights of access. Consequently, he has the total responsibility. If the database something happens, it's the DBA who is hanged first. So DBA has to be a very trusted individual apart from being an experienced individual. Okay. The other users are given selective permissions using grant statement. Grant leave, grant this privilege, grant that. That is the word which SQL uses. This is another statement. This is not part of DML. Okay. Grant is part of which part? DCL, the data control language. These permissions can be revoked later. So I may give you permission, but suppose from a UG student you become a PG student, or from a research scholar you become an employee on a project, I may have to revoke some permissions, I might have to give you some new permission. All these tasks are done by the DBA. We talked about views. Insertion of values in a view actually means modification of values in the base tables. And modification is permitted only in simple views. Please remember what I said. View is a khoka, a table, bank table. So when you say update a view, ordinarily it will not mean anything. Because view is not a permanent thing at all. So if at all you say update this view, means you don't say view or table, you just say update some name. If that is a view, SQL interprets it to mean that update all the base tables. Now, in a complex view which has been created by multiple joins, it is not very clear that update or changes, insert, delete could make sense. Consequently, SQL says modifications are permitted only in simple views, which are actually subsets of single tables. But otherwise, if you want to insert, delete, update, you better do that with the base tables. Okay. This is no permission given, granted, required. But if you are permitted to modify values, which we shall see how that is to be done, then this is the only thing that you should be careful about. Schema modification. Let's say you have designed the schema, student table, course table, race table, maybe some other tables, attributes, etc. Now what will happen over a period of time, the database and operationalize the information system, people registering, people like us will be giving grades, academic office will be computing CPIs, all this will continue. All of these will cause changes into the data in these tables. But will you agree that the schema of these tables is unlikely to change every day, every hour, every minute? In fact, it should not change at all. For a good design, the design should stay for years. Of course, there is always a requirement that some new functionality of my academic business might demand some additional field, in which case I will have to add columns to a table, or I will have to add new tables, or I'll have to delete some existing table. This activity is called schema modification. And what is being asserted here is, While data changes will occur regularly, schema changes are very infrequent. Not only that, they must be handled with great care. For example, I change the schema of a table where a CPI which was defined, I don't even add any new column, delete any column, but I just change the characteristic of a column. So from numeric 4, 2, okay, I change it to numeric 4, 3. Something must happen inside where old values are mapped to this new characteristic. 4, 2 to 4, 3 means what? Three digits are decimal point, only one integer digit. So people who have 9.9 CPI will get 9.9. People who have 10 CPI will get 0. Because only one integer can be kept there. So it has to be done with great care. Okay. Alter table command is the command which permits schema modification. When the table structure is changed, what happens to values of existing and new columns is to be understood. Suppose I add a new column. Then when I alter a table, a new table is created. All existing values, wherever pertinent, will be migrated to the new table. If there are new columns, it will not create data from the sky. It will expect data entry to be done through insert statements later. But appropriately then, this column should be nullable because only null value can be given at that time when I migrate the data. Remember, alter table will change the structure of an existing table, means essentially it will create a new table. It will move all the data from this present table to the new table and delete the old table. That is what alter table means. Thank you so much.